5 seconds to get my attention. Let us join together in morning entertainment. O God of grace, how often we have come to this place, seeking to celebrate our successes, but maybe to confess our sins. Far too often, we have spent time in the week, leading up to Sunday, failing in our personal battles with temptation and the devil.
Well, good morning. Lisa and I are so glad to see both of you here this morning. We brought something for you to look at. And does anyone know what Lisa is holding right there? I want to read you a story. This is a fishing lure. And what you do is you tie it to your line, you toss it into the pond, and you drag it through the water. When the fish sees it, he thinks it's some kind of nice, juicy fish, and he thinks, oh boy, breakfast. He doesn't notice the sharp hook on it. So as he tries to take a bite, and then, uh-oh, he gets caught, and then he becomes breakfast. If he just kept his mouth shut, he wouldn't get caught. So a fisherman uses a lure to tempt a fish into biting. If the fish gives in to temptation, then he gets caught. Well, you know what? Satan does the same thing to us. He tries to lure us into sinning by making things that are bad for us look good. And by the way, Satan tempts everybody. In fact, he even tempted Jesus. But Jesus said no to Satan's temptation. And you know what? He wants us to say no too. Let's have a word of prayer. Father God, we know that Satan is constantly tempting us to sin. So we pray that we remember to be like Jesus and always say no to temptation. We pray this in his holy name. Amen. We're so glad that you came up here today. Here's your bulletins. Thank you so much.
From Matthew 4, 1 through 11. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And he fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and afterward he was hungry. And the tempter came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." But he answered, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and set him on the pinnacle of the temple and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will give his angels charge of you. And on their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone." Jesus said to him, "Again, it is written, you shall not tempt the Lord your God." Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and the glory of them. And he said to him, "All these I will give you if you will fall down and worship me." Then Jesus said to him, "Begone, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve." Then the devil left him, and behold, angels came and ministered to him. These are the words of God for the people of God.
Let us pray. Most gracious and loving God, anoint me with your Spirit, that as I speak, O God, by your very grace and presence, may it be you who speak through me. And open all our minds and our hearts to receive this word, that we may grow by it in understanding and in behavior. That in everything, O God, we may glorify you and grow strong in your relationship. For this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. A lot of people believe that the temptations of Jesus are nothing like theirs. That Jesus somehow was tempted in a way that you and I can't appreciate, and that our temptations aren't like his, and therefore makes ours excusable. The reality of it is that in the temptations of Jesus, we see and are given an understanding of how temptation works, and from that we can draw strength. We can draw understanding, and we can draw power to deal with the devil and the temptations that come our way. But before we do that, we need to first of all understand how Jesus was being tempted by Satan, and then understand how in that Satan is tempting us. So the first temptation, the first slide, Satan comes to Jesus and says to him, "If you're the Son of Man, cause these stones to become bread." Now, he's been in the wilderness for 40 days, and he hasn't eaten much of anything. He's been fasting. And he's hungry, and we think that what Satan is tempting with is to satisfy his hunger. In reality, what Satan is tempting Jesus to do is to satisfy something that's deeper. What he's trying to tempt him to do is to satisfy Jesus with this idea, look, test it now. Let's see whether or not you have the power of the Son of God to meet people's needs by turning this bread, the stones into bread just to meet your own need. If you can do it for you, you can do it for everybody. You can do it for everybody. And then nobody will ever be in need when you're around. That was the temptation Jesus experienced. How about you and me? How do we get tempted with the idea that we can get to a place in our life where we never be in need again? I'm 61 years of age, and at 61 years of age, there's one thought that is sort of nagging with me, and Satan is using it. He's using it to the point of ad nausea, and it revolves around a word called retirement. Any of you know what that's like? For me, it's about being financially stable enough to be able to retire, now get this, comfortably. You know what's wrong with that word comfortably? It has to be qualified. And qualified for me means I'd like to retire and do all the traveling that I've not been able to do so far. I'd like to be able to go out and eat at a restaurant whenever I want. And I'd like to be able to go to the store and buy things and not have to worry about whether or not I'm going to have enough money at the end of the month to pay the rest of the bills or feed myself. In other words, I want to live so that my life is a constant place of comfort. Now, those of you who are retired, what's the likelihood that that's really going to happen? Here we go. The reality is that what Satan is tempting us with, show the next slide, is that God won't provide. You see, when I think that way, I'm not trying to lean on God. I'm not trying to be dependent on God. I'm trying to be dependent upon my retirement income. And that's where the danger comes in. And we do this with so many other things. We do this with when we want something that we know we need, but we don't need it the way we want it. For example, a new car. Now, I wanted a new car, one nobody else has owned before, because the last several cars that I have driven, somebody else owned before me, usually my wife. She gets the new one, and then I get hers, and that's been fine, and I've agreed to that, and I've been fine with that until this last one. And this last one, well, I got to place it. You know what? I deserve, hear that word? I deserve a new car. You remember those cartoons where an individual was wrestling with an issue and they've got a figure that looks like him on one side dressed in red and pitchfork and horns, and then there's one dressed in a white gown and has angel's wings, and they're both talking to the individual, trying to get the individual to do what's right or wrong. When I was wrestling with this new car issue, guess which one was talking the loudest? Now, many of you already know I'm driving a new car. Guess which one won? See, that's the problem. This whole concept of provision, God providing, goes beyond simply making the rent or having money to eat on. We begin to broaden the concept of provision to the point that suddenly needs get superseded by wants. Jesus was hungry. That wasn't the problem. It was in his hunger he began to identify with the needs of humanity. And in identifying with the needs of humanity, he could have, had he fallen to temptation of Satan, he could have thought to himself, I have the power to meet everybody's needs so they never need to be in want. Had Jesus done that, think of all the souls that would have been lost because they would have been focusing on their needs instead of their need for God. Now let's look at how Jesus responded to that temptation. He says to Satan, man doesn't live by bread alone. Yes, I could turn that into bread, but even if I did and I could take enough bread from these rocks out here in this desert to feed everybody for a lifetime, they still need God. And that's the only need that can save them, if we meet that need, not just their need for bread. Same is true with our provision. Even if you and I get what we believe we need, it won't satisfy the deepest need in our souls for God. The next temptation that Jesus encountered was that Satan takes him up to the pinnacle of the temple, and he decides to tempt him with this idea, look, you're about to embark upon this ministry of grace and this ministry of salvation for people. Let's make sure, Jesus, that God's really with you in this, okay? Let's make sure of it now. Let's put it to the test. Throw yourself off here and let's see whether or not the angels come so that not even your big toe touches the ground. That's a paraphrase, just to... that even your foot doesn't touch the ground, you know, that you're going to be protected. Let's put it to the test so that you will have affirmation, Jesus. You'll know, Jesus, that because we're going to test it right now. The problem with that temptation is that if Jesus had taken that temptation, what would have happened when it came time for the cross? Would he then have had the strength of faith and his relationship with God if he had tested God that early on in his ministry to make sure that God was going to do what God was going to do? Let's look at how that temptation plays out in our lives. Let's go to the next slide. There's the temptation for us. We doubt that God will protect. We doubt that God will protect. Right now in this nation, we are seeing such a level of communication for fear that this nation is so broken and people are so distrustful that we can't communicate with one another anymore. We can't talk about anything. Have you noticed? Have you ever noticed when the subject of politics comes up, all of a sudden everybody kind of goes, look at the time. Or the subject of social concern comes up, or race relations, or any basic other subject that affects our society. We don't know how to communicate with each other about it, because the communication of fear has been so strong and so consistent and so persistent that we can't reach out to one another. We start to pull within. The same thing happens with us individually. It happens with us when suddenly we start to encounter things in our lives that we don't like or we don't want. We go to the doctor, and the doctor finds something. It's not conclusive, it's just something. But all of a sudden, that something becomes everything. Or we get a bill in the mail that we don't understand why it came to us. And we start to fret over it and concern over it, and we don't always know what to do about it. Or we get a statement from the bank. And all of a sudden, we become encased in a disposition of anxiety, worry, and fear. And out of that, we begin to become obsessive, compulsive, and trying to create and insulate ourselves from the things in this world that scare us. Satan wants to do that. He wants us to become so fearful and so fixated on what scares us that we won't move, that we won't act, that we won't reach out, that we will not have any courage. Because if he can scare us on the little things, he can keep us from the big things. If he can so frustrate us over the things that we think God isn't going to help us with, when God calls us to do the things that we really need courage to do, we won't do it. Jesus stood there on the pinnacle, and he looks at Satan, and he says, no, it's written, you don't put God to the test. No matter what, you don't put God to the test. You have faith. You have faith. You don't need to put God to the test. And if you need to put God to the test, that already shows you don't have faith. Then Satan takes Jesus up to this mountain, and he shows him all the kingdoms of the world. And he makes him this offer. Now, Jesus, now you're such a magnanimous and such a compassionate individual. I tell you what, I'll give you all these kingdoms and you can rule them from your wisdom and your compassion. You can be their ultimate leader and guide them in the way they need to go. But there's a little bit of a catch. You gotta worship me. You gotta worship me. But think about it, Jesus. Think about the fact that if you're running all these countries and nations and governments and so forth, you can make sure that everything's done right. No corruption. You can do that, Jesus. Think about that. One of the real problems with humanity is that we think that if everybody would just do it my way, you know, if every one of you in here today would just think the way I think and believe the way I believe, if everybody in here would just conduct themselves as I think is best, hey, there'd be no problems. for me. I don't know about you, but it'd be no problem for me because we'd all be doing it my way, right? That's where Satan gets us, doesn't he? Let's look at the, there it is. We want more than God promises. You see, the reality of it is that the other line that I wanted to put up there was, we really want to be God. We don't want God's promises. We want to be God. We want to be in control. We want to basically make sure that everything is run as smoothly because it's running the way we think it ought to run. The bad thing about dictatorships is the only one who's happy is the dictator. You ever notice that? Every single day when I get on my high horse and I start spouting my diatribes, you all get to hear this because Roberta has to hear it and then she straightens me out. But the reality is every time I get on my high horse and think that, you know, if everybody would just be this way or be that way, God comes along and says, really? Really, Ron? You think that's how it's going to work? He reminds me of what it was like growing up. I grew up in a household of seven, mother, father, and five of us kids. Now, think of a household of seven individuals where everybody wants it that way. And God reminds me of that. Because that's ultimately ends up how it works out. We all start doing it. And that's exactly what Satan wants to do. And it's exactly what we're seeing at work in the world today. We're seeing it where everybody thinks that they've got the answers if everybody else would just comply. Really? Do we honestly believe that's what's going to happen? Do we trust God enough that God's promises will be enough to make us happy? That God's promises will be great enough to give us fulfillment? Do we trust God enough to let God be the focus and let God be the one calling the shots? And all we have to do is just comply with God as God sees fit, not you or me. So there's the temptations of Jesus. And ultimately, they're the same temptations we have. Now, I'll grant you, we're not starving in the desert and having rocks turned to bread. We're not being taken up to a pinnacle and tested to step off. We certainly aren't being taken up to the mountaintop and being shown all the kingdoms, which will become ours, though we do tend to look at the kingdom of our own backyard. But the reality of it is that our temptations really aren't any different from Jesus. What's different is how Jesus responded to them. Take, for example, how he responded to that last one. Be gone, Satan. For it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve. The next slide, I think, helps us. That's a herd of elk. Notice how close they are together, bunched up. As long as they stay bunched up and they keep the youth and the young ones in the middle of the herd, they're protected against wolves. The wolves will not take on a herd of elk. That's not where the danger comes in. The next slide shows you where the danger comes in. When an elk gets separated from the herd, now he falls prey to the wolves. And you can see them. They've got him surrounded, don't they? And it won't be long before he'll be lunch. The reality of it is that's exactly how it is with us and Satan. We take Satan on by ourselves, folks, we're going to lose. We're not smart enough. We're not shrewd enough. We're not wise enough. The only way that you and I can stand up against Satan is we have to remember what Jesus did. Look at the next slide. See that individual there? He's struggling and wrestling. Notice who's behind him. Satan and Jesus. A little bit different picture than those two cartoon figures on either shoulder, isn't it? Because that's what's really going on. And you and I have the opportunity in every temptation to tip the scales. And the scales we need to tip is not, in a sense, guarded by what we want or how we think it'll play out, but who we're really going to listen to and believe in. Satan or God? See, the simple reality is the only way that you and I can actually defeat Satan is to remember we are stronger together than we are alone. The only way any of us can defeat Satan is to remember we're stronger together than we are alone. So we have to come together. We have to be together. We got to be there for each other. Look at the next slide. The only way to beat the devil with temptation is to bring God to it. Let God deal with him. But to do that, you and I have to put our faith in God. We have to honestly, truthfully, completely put our faith in God. And that's not easy. Because remember, Satan knows our wants. He knows our wishes. He knows our fears. He knows everything about us. He's not omniscient. He's not. But you and I broadcast it every day on Facebook, Twitter, talking with other people. We broadcast it every day. We can't beat Satan, but God can. So the next time you start feeling that tempting pull, that lure that Brian talked about, don't look at its shininess. Look for the hook. And then tell God, deal with it. I can't. Deal with it, God. I'll trust you.
But as we leave here, O God, let the living of our lives be the second. And let you, O God, be Lord of it all. To your glory, for your kingdom, for the good of your people and your church, we pray this. Amen. We have many for whom we need to be in prayer. We've already heard of the one concern of the individual at Parkview who died. Are there any others that you would like to lift up this morning? Thank you. Thank you, Susan. Thank you, Philly. Thank you so much.
Betty Haywood has surgery tomorrow.
Yes, and Wayne's still recovering from surgery.
And Joyce Faber.
And Earlene Loving is in the hospital and recovering from an illness, so let's keep her in our prayer.
And Bob Jinks is here.
Yes, Bob Jinks is here.
Oh, Bob, yeah, Bob Jinks is here. Yes, Bob.
I pray for the family of Glenna Ford, who passed away this morning.
Thank you.
Pray for the family.
Thank you. Thank you, Ronnie. Yes. Definitely keep her in prayers. Thank you for sharing. Let us go to Lord in prayer. Most gracious and loving God, so many people, so many needs, one great God to meet them all. You are greater than our needs, and your love and grace brings you to us even when we can't call on your name. We pray for all of these individuals and many that we share from our hearts. And we ask, O God, that out of your grace and wisdom, do what is needed. Bring peace, bring comfort. Where possible, O God, bring understanding. And help us, O Lord, to put feet to these prayers in ourselves. Wherever possible, to be your hands and feet, your eyes, your ears, your presence to those in need. That through it all, O God, you might be glorified and that your kingdom may be made stronger in this world against the evil powers that seek to destroy it. That this, your world, will thrive in your spirit and in your purpose. For all this we pray in accord with Christ Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father,
my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me."
has spoken for you. Judy, the body of Christ, spoken for you. Karen, the body of Christ, spoken for you. Sue, the body of Christ, spoken for you. Joan, the body of Christ, spoken for you. David, the body of Christ, spoken for you. Ronnie, the body of Christ, spoken for you. Broken for you. Charlie, the body of Christ, broken for you.
Amen.
Delbert, the body of Christ, broken for you. Frank, the body of Christ, broken for you.
And now let us join in the prayer after communion. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.